వెల్కమ్ టు ఈపీజీ పాఠశాల. ఐఎమ్ కే రాజన్, వర్కింగ్ ఇన్ ద డిపార్ట్మెంట్ ఆఫ్ హిస్టరీ, పాండిచ్చేరి యూనివర్సిటీ. టుడే అవర్ సబ్జెక్ట్ ఆఫ్ స్పీచ్ ఈజ్ ఇండియన్ కల్చర్ అండ్ ద పేపర్ విచ్ వీఆర్ డీలింగ్ ఈజ్ ఆర్కియాలజీ ప్రిన్సిపల్స్ అండ్ మెథడ్స్ అండ్ ద మాడ్యూల్ ఈజ్ ఆన్ రిలేటివ్ డేటింగ్ మెథడ్స్. So what is this relative dating methods is already I explained in my previous lecture, and now we are specifically dealing on the methods followed in the relative dating methods. When we see these relative dating methods, the main aim of the study is the past, as I told you, but to understand and appreciate the human behavioral activities in a chronological order based on material evidence that we recover from our archaeological excavation and explorations in course of time. To realize this scheme of study, the optimum chronological control over the material is must, and it is required to understand the cultural past. When as I told you that there are two major category of dating system, what we call it as a absolute dating system, and another is relative dating system. The absolute dating system that deals on absolute date, the relative dating system or relative dating methods is deals on only on the relative chronology. So there are several relative dating methods are available in the present context, of which one is purely on science, one is purely on history. In the sense of history, what we call it paleographical base or linguistic style or context in which that material is issued, or art and architecture, stylistic ground, this all comes under history. But whereas archaeological stratigraphy, that is the major dating system that we are following in archaeological excavation, is come under geology. And there are seriation method, world analysis, the rice core, several methods are available. So when we go for this one, relative dating, it is a process of determining age. But how you determining age is more important in archaeological context. So these techniques, among the techniques, the stratigraphy is one of the important relative dating methods that we are following. There are several, as you see that there are stratigraphy, seriation method, fluorine test, nitrogen test, geochronology, world analysis, deep sea cores, ice sheet cores, and pollen dating, and historical dating, and paleography. Among all, and when we go for archaeological excavation, you may not get a complete organic or inorganic material, but definitely you will be having a geological stratigraphy, definitely. So the stratigraphical stratigraphy becoming an important phenomena in dating this archaeological material that are recovering from a particular context. So in categories of absolute dates and the categories of relative dates, both are differs in approach as well as in methodology. So if you take this stratigraphy, this is the one which has been applied by the geologists first. From geology, it came to archaeology. So according to archaeologists or according to the archaeological methods, the artifacts that are found in successive undisturbed cultural layers can be dated relatively based on the principles of stratigraphy. The principles of stratigraphy are the principle of cultural stratification, or what we popularly call archaeological stratification, is fundamental, and it plays a dominant role in archaeological investigations. When you go this method, is first actually found in geology, or it is applied in geology, that Charles actually he developed this technology in stratigraphy. So far you see that there are several layers of are available in the picture. Among them, there are all the layers are superimposed. There are certain disturbances within the layers. Irrespective of that one, if you see the content of the stratigraphy and the context which we are getting this all stratigraphy goes one upon the other. So what we feel that according to their basic principle is that the lowermost level or the layer one is below the upper layer is considered is the earliest. The one is upper is considered as latest by the geologist. So that way the uppermost layer is considered as the latest one and the lowermost layer is considered as the earliest one, depends upon the which period the layer formed. And there are two difference between the geological stratigraphy, there is a archaeological stratigraphy. The geological stratigraphy formation is natural one, but whereas the archaeological stratigraphy is the cultural process, or you can say it is a cultural layers, it is a man-made layers, what we can call it, that is a natural one. When we go for stratigraphy with regard to their presentation by the senior geologist, and initially, though it is initially started by the geologist and botanist and paleontologist, a joined together, and they finalized this principle of stratigraphy by the geologist. The technique is borrowed from geology. Sir Charles Lyell shaped this concept of stratigraphy in geology and published in its outstanding book, Principle of Geology, in 1830. This concept has quickly caught by this our ancient archaeologist or previous scholars like C.J. Thompson, who created the three-age theory, and the Warshi and Kathleen and Mortimer Wheeler. And the Mortimer Wheeler is the first archaeologist who introduced in Indian context, particularly the site like Arikamedu and Brahmagiri, he followed this stratigraphy. So what sometimes we call it as a Wheeler's stratigraphy. And later on it was developed to suit the needs of the archaeology by Edward C. Harris in 1970s. He questioned that it is not advisable or it is not feasible to take the principle of geology directly from the geology and applying to archaeology. What his contention was, or what is the dispute about that one, was the geological stratigraphy, as I told you, it is a natural one, whereas that archaeological stratigraphy is a man-made. So there are a lot of difference between these two. So the law that has been followed blindly should be avoided. So that way Edward Harris, in his book on Principles of Archaeological Stratigraphy in 1979, devised a new method in the interpretation of the archaeological stratification, what we popularly call it as Harris matrix. So this work, the basic principle of the stratigraphy, according to him, if one cultural layer lies upon another, then the lower layer must have been deposited before the upper layer. So he simply says the two layers, one above the other, have chronological difference. But what is the difference, and the number of years of difference he didn't specify. But it is only the archaeologist who is excavating in a particular archaeological site has to decide. So as per this concept, the contextual layer, or in the contextual, which context we are getting this layer, on the top is considered is younger than the layer that found below. So if you are having a success of layers, would provide a relative chronological sequence from the earliest to latest. When if you go for geological stratigraphy, or we can say there are four major laws, what they saw, okay, geological, stratigraphical law. According to that, the law of superposition. So, the law of superposition is one above the other. So, that we are following in archaeological context also. The laws of original horizontality, in the sense, here when the layer is formed at the initial stage, for instance, if it is under the sea, it will, the all the layers will be in horizontal position. But that you can't expect in archaeology. Because when the man occupies a settlement or occupy a place, the place may itself is maybe undulated land or maybe having upside down. So the people, one man may be living on the higher side and another man may be living in a lower side. So the stratigraphically, if you see that, the layer will form according to the shape of the land. So that way it differs from what we call it from geology. And the laws of original continuity. So when you see that in geology, since it the volcano happens or it is a tilting has taken place when the earth is forming, that layer will be having continuous without any disturbance, unless otherwise through natural process. But in the case of archaeological stratigraphy, when you, after making this stratigraphy or after the formation of cultural layers, the next man who is living after him may dig or may disturb that ancient layer through which the continuity will be disturbed. So the archaeologist must be very careful when what we call it as a pit in the archaeological excavation or futures, that is one of the pit that is going down, cutting all the layers below, and the feature is one is raised above the ground. So if you are constructing a house or constructing a building, there will be two layers will be there. One is for the making a foundation, you cut all the previous layers, that what we call it as a negative layers. And when which you are raising a wall above the ground, that is called positive layers. So the negative layers and the positive layers, both are in contemporary nature. So unless otherwise you understand this negative layers and positive layers in the archaeological context, then you may date in differently. That's why he is telling the original continuity should not be followed here, because it is quite disturbed one. The laws of faunal succession in association with the paleontologist or with the association of paleobotanist, and there is a continuity of faunal that are found in archaeological stratification, what we call Villa Franchi, what we call it. So this faunal remains gives a good date for geological stratigraphy, so like mammals or other animals that are found in a particular geological stratigraphy, the same thing can be dated in another place also. So that cannot be followed in archaeology. So keeping, but irrespective of that, at the initial stage, this concept was directly borrowed and adopted in archaeological investigation, like C.J. Thompson and Worshi and Kathleen M. Kanyan, and also Mortimer Wheeler. These scholars have adopted, and the Mortimer Wheeler introduced this stratigraphy in our Indian archaeology. But this, from the time of Mortimer Wheeler, 1940s up to 1970s, that is almost 30 years, this has not been questioned by anyone. Why you are applying this geological stratigraphy directly in archaeological stratigraphy? So Edward C. Harris, in 1970s, through his book on principles of archaeological stratigraphy, questioned the application of geological laws directly in archaeology. So, in contrast to that, he devised a new method in the interpretation of archaeological stratification, which is popularly known as Harris matrix. So, this Harris matrix, the methodology that is followed in documentation also changes. So it works on a simple basic principle that if one cultural layer lies upon another, then the lower layer must have been deposited before the upper layer. The time interval between the deposition of two cultural layers may be a century or a millennium, depends upon the nature of cultural deposit. In the meaning is, when you are having a urban centers like what we are having today, big cities and urban centers, the accumulation of the cultural deposit is very vast. But if you go to a tribal village, where that cultural deposit is very thin. So we can't compare that 1 centimeter cultural deposit, it may be equivalent to your 1 meter cultural deposit in urban center. So the thickness of the layer should not be taken as a chronological scheme. So you have to understand in which context you are getting these cultural layers. So as per this concept, the contextual layer on the top is considered longer than the layer that is found below. Thus, the succession of layers gives a relative chronological sequence. For instance, if you see this picture, there are two. One is, you can see that there were pits dug below the one particular layer, and what we call it as a ceiling layer. And the same level above the floor, you can see that there are certain walls has been constructed. So the foundation, the foundation as well as the wall goes to a particular period. So in that way, the features that has raised above the ground, that negative feature that was dug below the cultural layer is considered as a one layer. That's why when you are preparing a map or preparing a stratigraphy, you must be very careful in identifying the ceiling layers. And any material for that matter found in a particular layer can be dated relatively or younger or older based on form which layer the particular artifact is recovered. The artifacts recovered from orderly placed stratified layers. Why we are telling orderly placed stratified layers means there should not be much disturbance by the later activities. So this would help to classify them in certain chronological order. For instance, if you are excavating any prehistoric site, you will get the Paleolithic tools at the lowermost level. Then after that you will get Microlithic tools, and after that get you Neolithic tools in different cultural layers, helps to determine the approximate date of a particular cultural layer. So this way the stratigraphy gives an excellent help, or extending an excellent help in giving a relative dating. And with the next one is a seriation method, or you can say the technological development, or the shape of the tools that has developed, or the shape of the implement that has developed. So these are having a different shape, but purpose is as implement. For instance, in this picture I have shown how the transport has developed from a small cart to a present car, or small tool to a present tool. So the seriation is a method of determining the age of artifacts based on the style, type and technology. So that in the transport you are having a different technology that you are using. The same way the tools also, different technology may be used. One may be used first, they may be used stone, second they may be used copper, third maybe they used iron. Even now we are having different type of steel is used. So the technological development also reflected in the tool seriation. So that way the frequency seriation is more strictly oriented to chronological ordering of the objects. So the chronological ordering can be made based on the style or based on the technology. So the origin and popularity and disuse of the artifacts also counts well. Some of the material is disused. For instance, stone tools has been disused. And the copper objects, for longer, after some time it has been, after the invention of iron, the copper object usage has come down. So the new technology once comes in, and the old technology may be given up. So that way you can identify the relative chronology also. For in on the same way, in the stratigraphy, you are having a ceramic typology. So in Indian context, what we consider as the black and red ware is the earliest pottery that are available in a proto-historic period. And after that, we are having a OCP, what they call awkward colored pottery. Then after that, you are having painted gray ware. After you are having northern black polished ware, and you are having rowletted ware. In a North Indian context, if you get a mid-Ganga Valley, we are having OCP and PGW, NBP as a cultural sequence or a ceramic sequence that gives a relative dating. And if you come to a South India, the same thing, you are having a burnished gray ware in Neolithic period, and you are having a black and red ware in Iron Age period, and you are having early historic period, you are having russet-coated painted ware. And even further in the late early historic period, you are having rowletted ware, retained ware, amphora, and even further medieval period, you are having a celadon ware, Chinese celadon ware. So based on these ceramic techniques, you can able to identify the dating. So these ceramics also gives the relative dating. When you go for typology, for instance, if you take amphora jars, that Heinrich Dressel has collected all the type of amphora that are available in and around Mediterranean Sea. Then he classified all these amphora based on the shape. And finally, he came to know that there is the chronological sequence in preparing these amphora. So based on that, he has dated all the amphora which is having a particular shape. So this is one kind of sequence or typological sequence which gives a relative dating. For instance, this Dressel has given 1 to 27 numbers for all the amphoras, and from 1 onwards it starts from almost middle of 2nd century BC, it goes up to 3rd century AD. So this 500 years, this amphora, the preparation of the amphora, the style of the amphora has changed. So based on the types, he has adequately given information about the relative dating. As you in Harappan context also, the early phase and the late phase, even the part looks alike for a common man. For archaeology, when you look deeper and deeper into the size, shape of these parts, you can identify whether which is earlier and which is later. In this picture, the bottom one is late phase. You can see the ring stand, or you can say S-shaped jar and the goblet that have kept. And if you see the early phase, even if you see the ring stand, the stem portion is very elongated. And you can see the S-shaped jar, it is well versed, and you are having polychrome. And sometime if you see the later pottery, you are having only the single chrome, or you can say single pigment, or you can say single color. So that way, based on this color, or based on the size, or based on the shape, you can say that it is early or late. This is one type of relative dating. And when you go to the bones also being now dated, there are two methods, the bones, for dating the methods, we are having two methods in the bones. And the bones are one of the important organic samples recovered in excavations. These bones help to reconstruct the various aspects of human life. Why we have to study the bone? So the bone, when you are studying the bone, you can identify the dietary pattern, whether vegetarian or non-vegetarian, all this will come into what type of animal they consume, all those will come, you will come to know, like a fish or goat or other buffaloes, all that you are coming, beef and all it is coming in under the dietary pattern. But when you are having this bone, when a particular type of bone available in a particular climate, if you say that if a camel is not available in South India, so it grows in only a particular climate. So this also gives a paleo climate. What type of climate was in existence during that time, like an elephant, and if you are a tiger or lion, all will survive in a particular climate. some of the dry zones, some of the animals will be only surviving in a dry zone, some of the animals will survive only dry zones, so unwet zones. So these type of climatic variation you can identify based on the bones. And trade network, what do you mean by trade network? Means some of the animals have been imported. For instance, horse is imported into India. It is not a local animal. So how the horse has come? If you take all the paintings, if you take all the sculptures available in India, that clearly shows that horse have been imported. So how it has been imported, the trade network is available. Some of the elephants have been exported from India. So that way the trade network also could be identified. And the ritual performed in ancient times also have to identify based on these animals. For instance, Ashwamedha Yaga, Hiranyagarbha, or whatever you say, that elephant are considered as one of the good animals. For even if the king is coming on the donkey's back, or if the king is coming sitting on the elephant's back, there are a lot of difference. The power difference. And even if the man is sitting on the donkey, is considered as he has been punished. So though both are animals, but animals are considered as one of the important element in the cultural life of the man, of the society. So that way, what type of animal you are getting in Magurusgari or in Vidarbha region, we got in a grave quite number of horse bones, or horse has been buried inside the megalithic tombs. So it shows that this ritual is performed for these horses. So therefore, the control over the date would help, or the dating a bone will help to identify the changing pattern of diet or climate or ritual and trade activities. And if you, how to date the bones, what are the methods are available? There are four methods, are major four methods. One is amino acid method, and another one is electron spin resonance method, what popularly called ESR method, and the third one is fluorine method, and the fourth one is a nitrogen method. Among these, the fluorine test and the nitrogen test is standing high, because of that it can easily identify the fluorine or nitrogen in the bone. Most of the groundwaters contain small amount of fluorine. So the fluorine ions combine with hydroxyapatite crystals of the bone to form fluoropatite. So a bone buried for a longer time will absorb more fluoropatite than the one buried for a shorter time. If you take a bone and measure the amount of fluoropatite available in the bone, you can able to say that which bone is earlier, which bone is later. This is one kind of relative dating. If in the case of nitrogen test, the same way, nitrogen test, bones are made up of calcium phosphate or fat, and bone protein or collagen. The collagen is very, very important. On death, the collagen decays at a uniform rate and turns into nitrogen. In the sense, the collagen decays and it is changes into nitrogen. Like fluorine method, the amount of presence of nitrogen is measured and dated accordingly. The rate of decay depends on physical and chemical composition of the soil. So archaeologists should not blindly rely on this date. In the sense, some of the deterioration of the bone, the collagen decays, decay will go very fast in certain physical and chemical composition of the soil. For calcium soil will be there, and saline soil will be there. There are different type of soils are available. So it depends upon that, the decay rate will change. So when you are collecting a bone from a particular soil context, and the same bone should not be compared with another bone collected with a different social or soil context. So when you are studying these bones, always you try to see that the bones have collected from a same culture, that soil context. So therefore, it is not universal. However, one can differentiate the date of the bones collected from a single deposit from a single burial. So in as archaeologists, normally when we are excavating, we excavated in a trenches, so excavation trenches. So the material that we are collecting from the bones that are collected from a particular trench definitely will help to date the bones. In the same as geochronology, so this geology also helps to date the material, what we call it as a worm analysis, deep sea cores and ice sheet cores. Then what do you mean by this worm analysis? So when the streams flowing into a still water bodies, what do you mean call it tank or what you call it lake, that the water flowing directly from the upper region or in the mountainous region, it comes to a depressed area, what you call it as natural tank or lake, commonly create a silt deposit in summer and clay deposit in winter. And the Swedish scholar Baron Gerard de Geer in 1870 noted a regular alteration between the coarser silt deposit by glacial melt water in the summer. So what he want to say that one means, when every year when the water comes from the higher zone, it brings all and all these bigger granules are like a sand, will go, coarser varieties will go at the bottom and over which the clay will form. And next cycle, again that coarser sand will come or soil will come, over which silt will come. So this will create some worm formation. So based on that, they can able to date the material. This is called worm analysis. When we go for deep sea cores, and when you are boring, put a bore and you remove the soil sample, certain microscopic marine organism may appear. For instance, when they bore in a local archaeological site, particularly in the famous dockyard, they have bored there and they take out the sample. The sample contains the foraminifera microorganism. But this foraminifera microorganism will always survive only in sea waters. At present, this Lothal site is in dry zone. There's no sea nearby. So how the water has reached to the Lothal site is a big question that has been raised by Dr. S. R. Rao. So the explanation is given like that. When the sea level rises, or what we say sea level fluctuation, or what they call it high tidal times, when the high tide goes, that the water will enter into the land and it comes up to the dockyard. So the boat or ship will come along the high tide waters and sea waters and will come and anchor in the dockyard. And during the time of low tide, the water recedes. During that time, the boat goes back or ship goes back. Because the seawater enter into the dockyard, that's why we are getting a foraminifera. That was the idea which has been proposed by Dr. S. R. Rao, and he declared that based on this foraminifera, this dockyard is what the people are disputing, that is as a irrigation tank. Or some people are telling it is dockyard. So he proves that one, this is a dockyard according to him. So that way, these deep sea core analysis helps to identify whether there was a sea activities. Next one, when we go for historical documents, and there are several ways you have a relative dating with regard to historical documents. And there are seals, copper plates, inscriptions, palm leaf manuscripts, and or any other written document like a papyrus which we are getting in Egypt. So any written material will contain two major things. One is the paleography or the script. The second one is the language in which that script is used. So in that way, you will get two things. One is that content of the inscription will carry the linguistic style, and also the purpose for which the written document is carried. And based on that content, you can date it. So, relatively you can date it based on that. So, even for all our Meikirtis, what they call it, preamble, what they call it in the inscription, and Prasasti, what they call it in Sanskrit, that the nature of process Prasasti has changes over the years. If you take it Cholas or Pandyas or any other kingdom. So, based on the Prasasti, they will date it. So, this is one type of relative dating. And the inscription, the script also developed and also changed, like a Brahmi into Vattaluthu character, that also has been dated. That can be dated based on the paleography. And the material in which they have written, that like if you take a copper, they have written, or they have written in iron pieces, or they have written in papyrus, or based on that also you can date the document. And if you on a architectural style, that the variation within the architecture, based on that also you can date the site. For instance, this rocket cave is not having any decoration at the entrance. It is a very plain rocket cave, what we considered as the earliest rocket cave. And if you go to next level, and there are some decoration is started appearing in the rocket cave. It is a simple entrance, any without any dwarapalakas or without any pillar. So if you go to another next stage, you see that it was beautifully cut into the natural rock, or what we call cut-in temples. And if you see the entrance, and you could see the steps, and you can see the Adhisthana, and there is an inscription in front of it. So it, that rocket cave, from simple, it is moving towards a complex position. If you see in this rocket cave, and you are having a pillar, and even before that entrance, we are having some space, and we are having a plasters on the both the side, and you are having a cornice, and you are having that the rainwater should not enter into the cave. Then you are having a dip on the top. So on the left side and right side, that pillar is started appearing. So this is on the stylistic ground. They will say it is little late. Now when you come to further late, you are having a beautiful cut-in caves in which you are having a beautiful pillars, and you are having a front mantapa, and you are what we call Mukha Mandava, and you are having Maha Mandavas, and you are having Andaralas, and you are a Santum Santorium, or you can say shrine cell. All has been made, and elaborate rocket caves have been made in the course of time. So from simple to complex, it has developed. So based on the style of the architecture, you can relatively date it. So thus, in that way, the relative dating based on paleography, based on art, based on architecture, based on the stratigraphy, or based on other nitrogen test, fluorine test, or geochronology, the relative dating can be made. But irrespective of that, absolute dating stands valid even today. But this relative dating, approximately you can date it for centuries, but not within a decade. So that way, the relative dating is having its importance when you are not having an absolute date. So the archaeological and historical documents basically need certain degree of assistance anyway to fix the date. To meet these chronological settings, our archaeologists increasingly rely on relative datings drawn from different fields like stratigraphy, paleography, stylistic pattern in the field of art and architecture, and many other fields are coming up to date archaeological material by using the relative dating methodology. So, thank you.